hear the song that we're singing. Come on, get happy. A whole lot of loving is what we'll be bringing. We'll make you happy. We'll make you happy.
Hey, everybody. Welcome once again to Toy Talk. Now, this month, right off the bat, we're going to be talking about faith. Now, hold on. Don't tune out on me. I know most people tend to think of faith in reference to religion. Now, let me assure you, we are not talking about religion this month. What I'm saying when I use the word faith is I'm saying believing that something good is going to happen, even when you have no reason to believe that something good is going to happen. Now, before I can really explain what faith is, I need to take a little time to explain faith's opponent, its opposition, which is fear. Now, most people, when they hear the word fear, tend to think of being afraid. Now, that's part of fear, but it's not really what fear is. Now, if you're walking down the streets of Boston and suddenly a king cobra jumps out at you and it starts to strike at you, be afraid. You know, that's a dangerous situation that can hurt you. Now, that is not fear, and it's perfectly normal to be afraid. Now, conversely, if you're walking down the streets of Boston and you're looking all over the place worried, oh my gosh, what's gonna happen if a king cobra jumps out at me? What am I gonna do if it bites me? I'm gonna die. And you're looking here and you're looking there and looking for a king cobra. That is fear. See, fear is illogical. There is no reason to believe that a king cobra is gonna jump out and strike you, especially on the streets of Boston. And if you're walking around expecting bad things to happen, that is what fear is. Fear is, again, illogical. It's believing that something bad is gonna happen when you have no reason to believe that something bad is going to happen. And people have a lot of fears. I was recently talking to a friend who has an adult son, a young adult, who had moved into his first apartment. And she went over to visit him. Her son has a very strong fear of spiders. Now, as she went to visit him, she was looking around the apartment and she said, something seems odd here. It looked like all the walls were covered in saran wrap. And she was wondering, what's going on here? And suddenly it dawned on her. What her son had done is he had taken double-sided tape and he had put it up and down the walls of his apartment so that if a spider came in, it would get stuck on the tape and it wouldn't be able to hurt him. That is fear. It's illogical. He had no reason to believe a spider was going to come in the apartment. And even if it did, he had no reason to believe that it would be a dangerous spider. And even if a poisonous, dangerous spider did come in his apartment, he had no reason to believe it was going to come to him and harm him. And yet, he expected that bad thing to happen. He was living in fear. Now, living in faith is exactly the opposite. It's believing that something good is going to happen, even when you don't see how something good is going to happen. Now, let me put it to you this way. There are ways that we can build up faith in our lives. Just as focusing on those negative things, focusing on those fears, the things we're afraid of, builds fear in our life, focusing on things that we want can help build faith in our lives. Now, a couple of things that I do, something I do every evening, and I would suggest this to anybody, is when I head to bed, I turn on my cell phone, I have it charged into a power bank, I turn it on, flip to YouTube, and I put on recordings of positive affirmations. Stuff that say, you know, you are successful, you are healthy, whatever it may be, you are intelligent. Or sometimes I'll listen to subliminal music, music that has a message underneath that, you know, says to help you with health or finances or whatever it may be. And these things are playing through my mind all night as I sleep. I run them. Now, during the day, and even in my home, in my bedroom specifically, another thing I do is I have a vision board. Now, what a vision board is you take things that you want to manifest in your life, the way you want your life to be, and you find pictures or words, and you put them literally up on a board, a vision board. You don't necessarily have to spend time staring at it or focusing on it. You can do that. But just having it around helps you to think about those things. And what we think on tends to manifest. As we think, so we are, is an old saying that goes around that's very true. It's like I've mentioned many times before, the law of attraction. I mention that a lot because I believe in it. What we send out, we tend to bring back in. And what we focus on tends to come into our lives as well. Now, on this vision board, it doesn't have to be anything really significant. I have a happy family. I have places I'd like to travel. You know, there's different things. I want to be a best-selling novelist. You know, I have pictures of things that make me think on those things. And I believe that as you focus on those, they have a tendency to manifest in your life, even as when we focus on the negative, that has a tendency to manifest. Now, of course, we would rather have the good, faith, manifest in our lives rather than fear manifesting in our lives. Now, in reference to faith, there's an old verse that I really like that always kind of I find uplifting. And it says to have faith as a child. Now, every time I read this or hear this, I tend to think of it as referring to a young child, like a toddler. Because you look at a toddler and they expect good things to happen. Toddlers do not live in fear. They walk around, man, they'll try attempt the stairs, even though they don't realize they could fall down and get hurt, they try to climb up it. They'll try all these different things that may be dangerous, but they don't expect anything bad to happen. They go out there expecting good because they don't know otherwise. And when something bad does happen, it's a shock to them, it surprises them. This is when you hear a child scream. It's not that they don't get afraid, it's that they didn't know in advance that anything bad could happen to them. They expected good. They were living in faith. Now, this is, of course, where the third part of the puzzle comes in as adults. We have knowledge, we have wisdom. Like I said at the beginning when I started speaking, if you see a king cobra coming at you, you know that's dangerous. Get out of there, avoid it. Be afraid, it's understandable. See, but a young child, like a toddler, will walk right up to a stove that's hot and touch it because they don't realize it can hurt them. And then, man, they suddenly realize that hurt me, but they never expected it. We, of course, have the knowledge that if we go up and touch fire or touch a stove, it's going to hurt us. So we have the ability to use wisdom to avoid those dangerous situations. So living in faith is not necessarily saying that dangerous situations aren't out there and that bad things don't happen. It's focusing on the good things and expecting those to happen. And when we see a bad situation, and bad situations do occur, we know to try to avoid them, to do what we can. We need to learn to live in a way that helps us to focus on the good. And that's how good things will manifest in our lives. It's all about living in faith and having faith as a child. Now we're going to cut to commercial, and we'll be right back with our Toys of the Week.
Hey, hey, look at me and Weeble. Me and Weeble go all around. One day, kids pretend they're flying into Weeble Airport. Next day, they play around the Weeble Cottage. Or if it's real nice, they go out to the Weeble Marina and go fishing. Hey, hey, look at me and Weeble. The Weebles waddle, but they don't fall down. Romper Room makes Weeble toys.
At Sesame Place, short people have big fun.
Short people got a good reason to smile. With our new neighborhood, the fun never ends. It's a new place to play with Sesame friends. They're gonna laugh and giggle all the day, and maybe learn a little while they play.
New Sesame Neighborhood. Take Route 1 to Oxford Valley exit. Sesame Place, Langhorne, Pennsylvania.
Now it's time once again for our Toy of the Week. And over the last several months, I've brought in several of my favorite toys, and every one of them has a special meaning to me, a little something that makes them stand out as toys that are special to me and special as part of my collection. And that is very much the case with this month's toy, which is my 1970s rubber hand Ernie. Now, Ernie was put out by Fisher-Price in the early 1970s. He does not have a tag, so it's hard to give an exact year on him. I've seen posts online that say he came out around, they believe, around 1970 to 72. A lot of them just say 70s. I tend to think it was a little later because I remember owning this, and I was born in 1971, so I don't think I'd remember a toy that was made in 70 to 72. I tend to think it was more around 75 that I owned it, but he did come out, I think it was released more than 1 year in the 70s. You know, he came out maybe in 71, 73, 76, whatever it may be. But he was the rubber head model. He's got rubber hands. And there's a few reasons why this particular puppet and this particular toy is special to me. First, as I just mentioned, I had it as a child. And I love finding toys that I had as a child. I remember playing with, remember spending time with. Another thing is that I loved Sesame Street as a child. I'm still a big fan of the Muppets, and that was my initial introduction to the Muppets was Sesame Street. And as I watched Sesame Street, I remember always loving Ernie and Bert the best. When Ernie and Bert came on the air, it was like, man, all right, this show is about to get good. You know, and my favorite of those two was Ernie. Yeah, and it makes sense, you know, when you look at how I've become as an adult, he was kind of the goofball. You know, he was the guy that came in with the laugh, you know, and I'd love when he was in his bathtub and he's singing like, you know, rubber ducky, you're the one, you make bath time lots of fun, you know, but Ernie was always my favorite character on Sesame Street. So it was a toy I had, it was a character I loved, but there is something more to this toy and it's something more significant to me. I've mentioned many times that I have 5 children. My oldest is about to turn 16. My second oldest, Anna, is 14. And the others are getting up there. You know, we've got a 12, 10, and almost 8-year-old. Now, Anna, who just turned 14, when we first moved here, was about 8 years old. And so that was around the time that I got into collecting toys. And she was just at that right age where she would come out with me to the flea markets, to the auctions, to different things, looking for toys. Now, she's 14 and she doesn't want to do that stuff anymore. She doesn't want to hang out with dad and the toys aren't cool. Going out looking for toys is not cool and having a house full of toys is definitely not cool. But one thing I love about this toy is when she was about 9 or 10 years old, we were together at the Linway flea market and it was a day we'd gone to a few yard sales, we'd gone to some flea markets and we weren't really finding anything. And we had actually gone through all the Linway flea market and we're heading back to our car. When all of a sudden, Anna just says to me, hey, Daddy, what about this? And I look over, and she's pointing at this particular Ernie doll, the one that I had as a child. And not only that I was now getting it back, but I was getting it back because my daughter found it. And now that she's getting older and not enjoying this stuff as much as she did as a child, and I'm hoping she will again as an adult, but, you know, she's in that teenage years where they don't tend to want to spend a lot of time with the things that we think are cool because they're not cool to them. So whenever I look at this, I remember those times of Anna spending time with me, going out to the flea markets, looking for toys, and it has a warm place in my heart for that reason. So we're going to cut to messages and we'll be right back with our special guest for this month.
Fisher-Price toys run on child power. The boundless energy of small moving bodies. The stubborn push and pull of a child's curiosity on the way to learning something new. Imagination. A toy that's fueled by imagination can travel very far. Over the land, into the air, through the stars. That's child power. And we believe in it.
This toy first came out in 1952. It was the very first toy ever advertised on television. In the year 2000, it was inducted into the National Toy Hall of Fame. In recent years, many versions have been made with popular movie themes such as Star Wars, Transformers, and Indiana Jones. Originally, it was just a box of random body pieces that could be stuck into a vegetable. It wasn't until 1964 that the toy received the body we know today. Of course, this toy is Mr. Potato Head.
Well, this month we're talking about having faith like a child, and my guest has the perfect collection to go along with this topic. Let's welcome Christopher Pizzo. Hey,
thank
Chris,
you
how you doing?
Me. Good, thank you for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. Glad to have you on here.
Great.
And Chris mainly collects preschool toys. You're the only collector I know that you know focuses on toys for like toddlers and preschool students. Now, what got you into collecting that?
Well, I collect all types of toys,
yes.
Not just preschool toys, but mm-hmm. I get figurine shelves, just regular knickknacks, action mm-hmm. figures, and
That's true.
I just saw some Fisher-Price toys, and I thought, wow, this would be really good for my collection just to have on my shelf, you know, just for eye candy.
Yeah, absolutely. All every toy collector, pretty much every person, at least in America, as a little kid, you know, in the, you know, not maybe necessarily in inner cities, but, you know, that had any kind of money at all, had Fisher Price toys. You can even just, not even have to call them toddler, because Fisher Price just dominates the market when it comes to toddler and preschool toys. Now, and it's interesting how we came about that. Most of the people I know that have been on the show have been on, because I've met them through collecting, through toys. Chris and I met through a mutual friend on Facebook, and one day we just kind of wound up video chatting, and I saw all these toys in the background, and I was kind of like, hey, wait a minute, man, what's this? And spotted the preschool toys, and we said, that would make an interesting episode for Toy Talk.
Yes, well, right, I'm glad you had me on the show.
Is there, what was the first thing you picked up as far as toddler toys go?
That would have to be the Happy Apple Chime toy.
You know what, let's bring that right on up.
Okay. This is a official 1972 from Fisher Price.
And of course, it makes the little jingling thing. I always thought it was called the Roly-Poly Apple, but it's actually technically the Happy Apple.
Yep,
it's Happy Apple. Of course, Fisher Price, and like you said, 1972. It's one I remember having as a kid. For some reason, I kind of remembered it rolling. It actually does roll. Okay, I thought it didn't from the way it's sitting. It's got kind of a flattened bottom, but it does.
Yeah, weebles wobble, but they don't fall down.
Exactly, and so do apples, apparently.
Yep.
This thing can fall off the tree, but it's not going to knock Darwin out.
Yeah,
but it's a cool toy. It's one you don't see every day.
Exactly. I found that on eBay. Paid $30 for that. Mm-hmm. Now, when that came out in 1972, I would imagine that
$1.99 maybe, or like, something. Yeah,
like my parents might have spent $2-3.
Inflation has increased the apple price of apples.
Yeah. Now, there was one in my house. I don't know if it belonged to me or my brother, but I do specifically remember having one in the house. And you know, I think it's a pretty good toy for a toddler because it's safe.
Like,
I mean,
knock it down.
Right.
It's safe as long as they don't throw it at their brother or sister.
Well, I mean, if they're a toddler, I know that wouldn't be good. I wouldn't recommend that.
Yeah.
But
See, I've got kids. I learn these things.
And toddlers, you know, real young toddlers don't have teeth, so they might be like teething or something. So they can actually pick it up and put it in their mouth.
Chew on that a little bit. Yeah.
Yeah, because those are in there pretty good. There's no loose pieces. They can gnaw on the back of the apple. Nothing's going to happen to them. And you know, I think it's really cool. The chime when you shake it.
Yeah, they love the noise.
It jings. It draws them to it. And you know, look at that cute face on that apple.
Oh, I mean, I know.
How could you not like something
as cute
like
as the
that?
One here.
I know. You know.
It's just really a cool toy.
I mean, it's just like, you know, can we get that?
And there's so many classic toys.
Yeah, there we go.
That are brought out by Fisher Price, but that was one of the ones that really kind of caught my eye. And the other one that really just got my attention. I don't want to play this because it'll kind of just keep rolling forever. The music goes on and on, but it's a Fisher Price, you wind it up and it's a music box, but and it's got the really infamous Little People, which really has been one of Fisher Price's, I mean, especially in the 70s, it was their huge thing. They had the castle play sets and Sesame Street. Everything was the Little People.
Exactly. Little People were a big thing for Fisher Price, and this is a pretty cool toy as well.
You do the little turn.
Yeah, just give it a
and
little.
The Ferris wheel takes them on a ride. But it's a really cool little innovation. I mean, especially for the 70s, it wasn't, you know, usually that kind of thing would be crank, but you know, you get a little turn and boom, there it goes. It's a fun toy.
It's actually kind of cool. I mean, if you can see the little people in there, I mean, this little boy, he kind of looks a little bit upset.
Yeah, he doesn't look too happy to be on the Ferris wheel. He must
not
like heights or something.
Right,
I
mean, what did he get on to begin with? And
you think the designers might have put the little happy apple smile on there.
Exactly, and I'd like to know exactly what kind of an amusement park lets a dog on the Ferris wheel.
That's another question. And again, that might be a 70s thing. You see it nowadays.
I mean, you know.
It's an interesting choice of characters. You're right. I hadn't thought about that.
Yeah.
But it's a cool toy, and it's one, again, that you don't see every day. But, of course, Fisher-Price has a lot that you do see on a regular basis. They got those classic toys, such as the Chatter Telephone.
The Chatter Telephone. Okay.
I think just about everybody had this. You pull it, you make the little, again, special noises for the kids. You turn it, and it cranks.
Yeah, I keep them into the box because... Mm-hmm. It's just easier to stack onto the
better for display.
Yeah, on my shelf. Yeah. So it, like, you can't stack one on the other if they're out of the box, but mm-hmm. you get a complete flat surface so I can put one on the other for
Absolutely.
Display.
Absolutely. Now, if it wasn't in the box, if I remember right, the telephone, you can pull it like what a string and the eyes actually
yes,
roll. Too.
The eyes so actually do move. Yeah, I think it's up and down.
Get them to kind of yeah. just flicking them. But if it was rolling, the eyes would go up and down with it. Yes.
I think there is a string under it so you can drag it along the floor where the eyes do go up and down. Not quite sure if I remember, but yeah.
But yeah, that's the general purpose. They kind of roll around. It's just, it's one of those toys you see all the time, kind of like. Let me set this down and let's bring up the see and say, which I always want to say speak and smell when I start talking about this toy.
Infamous.
Totally different toys, but.
See and say.
Of course, the original one had the pull string. Oh, and this does, oh, I'm sorry, this does have a string.
Yep.
More of the more modern ones have the crank now.
Oh, yes.
You know, you pull it down. But these, you had the string, you pull it, and it's just, here's a chicken. Or I always remember for some reason sticking my head is, the cow says, moo, moo.
Yep.
You know, I just get this. And it's just, it's a cool toy. It teaches kids the sounds of animals. It's got a lot of, you know, actually, I can say this about all the Fisher-Price. Lots of bright colors,
mm-hmm.
you know, which get their mind going,
mm-hmm.
help them learn. They're learning toys. They're fun. Like you said, they're not, I mean, I say they're not dangerous, but then I keep coming back to my kids young or just young kids and like, they're not a dangerous toy, like you said, to chew on and stuff, but man, they're hard plastic. And, you know, it can, it's not dangerous to the individual playing with it, but possibly to a playmate.
Well, there's got to be some reason why they put warning labels on everything nowadays.
Yeah,
there's
yeah.
got to be somebody out there who made them do it.
See, they didn't have those warning labels when these came out in the 70s. We have them now because these came out in the 70s.
People, right.
Yes.
So, yeah, I mean, if you can go to anything, like, let's do the frog.
Oh, yeah, you can line it up. Yeah.
And these things are still pretty good, even as adults. I'm not sure if I would have graduated college without this thing.
I joke sometimes about the speak and spell saying the same thing. That thing kept me out of high, kept me from graduating. No, could have kept me from finishing high school, but messing things up on it.
Yeah, but this is all the animals on here. I don't know. Let's do one more.
Let's do one more, sure.
Let's do coyote.
Okay. And unfortunately, we're hearing a little too much of that lately around Ipswich and Gloucester.
Yeah, so I've heard.
Gosh, but a good warning sign for the kids. And I think you had one more toy over here. Is that correct?
Yes, this is the...
what was this? The record player. Yes,
box,
I did want to show that.
Player.
The music box record player. And if you look in on here, it was a record player in the 70s, but instead of playing the normal vinyl records, it was great for kids. They made these thick plastic records, and they would play songs like Happy Birthday, Pop Goes the Weasel, things like that.
Yeah.
Do you know what's on there?
Actually, it says right here, The Farmer in the Dell is one mm-hmm. of them. It doesn't really say on the box what's included.
Okay.
Each individual record, I don't know if I can, yeah, they're tied together.
Yeah, you don't want to pull them out. Don't break your box. But
yeah, the top one, The Farmer in the Dell, what you do is you put an individual record.
Just like a regular record player.
On here, and
it
winds
up. But it's
got
really deep grooves.
Right.
Yeah.
You wind it up, and you put the little needle thing onto the record,
yeah.
and as it winds up, it will play the song.
And at the time, it was a way for kids to be able to listen to records. This is before cassettes and CDs, and that way they're not going to break the vinyl. You know, nowadays, they just, 5 years old, they're turning on their iPhone.
You know,
they can listen to whatever music they want, but simpler times. And this is actually, obviously, these are re-releases of the toys, but what's kind of cool, I think, for me, about the record players, it was first released in 1971, which was the year I was born.
Ah.
So it's one of my original toys, you know?
And
I
did have one of these as a kid, and I was told years later, I don't remember because I was a kid, that I took the plastic records and put them in the toaster.
Oh, jeez. That was the end of them there. I guess you can destroy them
yeah,
then.
Yeah, you see, I mean, I don't remember doing that, but, you know, thinking about it, that does something sound like something I would do. Even today in my 40s, I probably would still do something like that.
It's kind of interesting to see what the plastic looked like afterwards. You know, get some good melt color.
Yeah, just put it in the toaster, just push it down, and you come out with a steaming plastic mess.
Yeah, I'm sure. And you also come back with no more toaster oven.
Yeah.
At least not for making toast if you want to cook some more records.
And a spanking.
I'm sure in the 70s that came along with it too.
Back in the earlier days.
I'm going to just reach down here. There's one last toy I want to talk about that you brought in. And this is, in my eyes, probably like the most iconic of the Fisher-Price toys. Of course, you got the popcorn popper, the bubble popper.
And yes.
I can't imagine, all of my kids had it, I had it. So, you know, over 40 years, I really can't picture a toddler without the popcorn popper. It's a really cool looking, it's an innovative toy. It's probably the most annoying toy ever made. You know,
probably,
you give this
yes.
thing to a two-year-old that is just learning to walk. One, it encourages them to walk. Mm-hmm. And two, it drives you insane with that popping noise. So it's a really cool toy, but it's just really different.
Yeah, any parent that gives these kids one for their birthday probably regrets it in 5 minutes.
Yeah, but then later you are thankful that it helped them learn how to walk, you know, in different
ways. Yes, true.
It's a cool learning toy.
And these are also good as an adult as well, because if you have a paranoid cat or a skittish cat or dog, you can just, you know, put it on the floor and go, come here, kitty, and just watch the tail.
It's kind of the secondary backup to the vacuum cleaner.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You watch the tail and, you know, the cat just goes right out of the room and chases it going, come here. You know,
yes,
so
man.
It's still
a lot of
fun.
I'm glad you brought this in. I would have never thought to do a preschool episode if I hadn't saw your toys, but there's just so much cool stuff, like I said, usually Fisher Price, and
yeah.
It's just great to do it. It's been great having you on the show, man.
Well, I appreciate you having me on the show.
We'll have you back again another time, maybe to do some of your other toys from the shelves and stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I got a big collection.
Action figures.
Have
to go through the rest. I really haven't seen much of the rest of your collection, so.
Yeah, well, I mean, you'll have to have you over someday.
Absolutely, sounds good. Hey. All right, and we'll see you guys next month when we come back for the next episode of Toy Talk.
Phenomena. Phenomena. Phenomena.
Hello? Okay, just a second. It's for you.